It's a great honor for me to be here with you. You work on important topics in interesting areas of business, and I will try to have a look on the developments in artificial intelligence and the debates we have around that issue with focus to the topics that you are interested in. Now, let me begin with a very general observation. Maybe 10, 20 years ago already, I always said in talks that a car is a very interesting type of robot. It is, of course, not self-understood that you would see a car as a robot, but if you have a very general view to intelligence, then on the most abstract level, what you do is you have a system that takes information from the outside, uses a device for computation, takes historical information whatsoever, intentions it has, and after a lot of computation, it will do something. So the essential thing is that from a sensoric side, you go to the actoric side. And survival means that you make use in a clever way of information to do activities in a clever way that you survive. That is the, let's say, the most general picture on intelligent systems. And that can be a human, that can be a tiger, that can be a company, or a university, or a state, or humankind. It's always the same. Always this complex system takes in information, does considerations, and then does something. And the kind of processes are quite diverse. Take a tennis player, then there is this tennis ball coming with, let's say, speed 130 kilometers an hour. And you get some information on the ball coming in your eyes. And then you compute something with this information. And then you send information to your arm and to your legs, and your combined activity of arm and legs in the end should mean that you hit that ball back with 100 kilometers and make a problem to the other guy. Yeah? So this information coming in, it's having considerations, and then it's doing something. And in the car, it's the same. So the car notice there you have problems with, let's say, with the stability on the ground, and then some system will act and do something, and by now the car is doing things before the human can notice at all that there's a problem. Yeah, because the sensoric of the car is better and the ability to do something of the car is better. So we profit from the car being better in doing this kind of activity. Now it's very interesting to ask yourself how much effort you have in this sensoric side, how much you have in this actoric side, and how much you have in the computation. And if you take the human brain, then for the sensoric side we are in the, let's say we do some 200 million neurons. 200 million neurons take in information. And we have 20 million neurons that are able to do something, move the legs. Yeah? So 200 million to take information, 20 million to do something. But the more interesting part is how much power do we have for computation? This is something like 1,000 billion. So you could say we have little capacity to take information in. We have even more little capacity to do something, but we have an enormous capacity to do some computations. You could, of course, also put it this way. We have some effort for information. Then we do computation without end. And in the end, essentially, we do nothing. That's very important if you study companies. then you would say there is an enormous amount of activity to do almost nothing. Of course, you can also see it the other way around. You can say that the real problem in the world is to do something. And therefore, one has to very carefully prepare what we do, because to do something is the real problem. I often put it this way: if you sit in the Alps, have a breakfast, and there is this mountain, and if you have the idea to jog up the mountain, maybe it's not the best idea, but if you should have this energy, you want to jog up the mountain, then of course it's a real problem when you up the mountain and you notice it's the wrong mountain. So you better think before you run up a mountain, because it's comparatively easy to think about jogging up a mountain. It's very difficult to do it. In engineering, they call this the 1 to 10 to 100 to 1000 principle. It's quite easy to have ideas, and I think all of you are full of ideas what we could do. It is 10 times as difficult to build a prototype. It is 100 times as difficult to make it a product. And it's 1,000 times as difficult to make it a product that stays in the market. So it's 1 to 10 to 100,000. And it means really, it's very important to do a lot of computations in order that you do something. Now, many people believe the essential topic is information. And of course, you could say the more information I have, the better. But there's also a problem. If you have an intelligent system and put more information into that system, the performance of the system becomes better. But if you always put more information into the system, then at some point performance is not better. And if you then put even more information into the system, then performance goes down. And the problem is that given the limited capacity of information processing of any given system at a particular time, if you put too much information into the system, then it's always more working on the meta level of what information to look in, given that the time is limited. And now, if I have always more information, then I have always more meta information, and I have to deal with always more meta information, with remaining always little time to do something. And in the end, I do only meta information, and I do nothing on the real information level, because I have so many offers in information that in the end I would say it's hopeless to do anything. Yeah? By the way, that you have this often in conferences, I have the feeling here everybody is in the unique track of this conference. There is other conferences, you have 20 tracks in parallel. Now, if you have 20 tracks in parallel, then you know that you will miss almost everything. So it doesn't matter whether you go into number 20 or not, you can go and drink a cappuccino, it makes no difference. So to have more offers doesn't mean that you win something, it really only means that you have information overload. So one has to deal very, very deliberately with information. And in many situations, what you need is only one information, yes or no. If somebody gives you the right yes or no, then you don't need all the rest. All the rest is only for this one yes or no. And one has to focus on this yes and no, and has to consider how do I get best to what I need, this yes or no. And not believe that by putting always more stuff into the system, something would improve. Now, if you look into the developments of the, let's say, last 30, 40 years, one interesting observation is how was the situation in the East before we had the fall of the Berlin Wall. The East was always, let's say, four processor steps behind us. So we had, let's say, four doublings more than they had, which makes in performance a factor of 16. So you could say our technology always had a factor 16 more power than they had. But concerning the results they had in science, there was no difference. And if you ask yourself, why was there no difference? Now, yeah, they were in competition with us. We had a factor 16 more in capacity. So they put some more brain into what they had. And a little more brain can easily compensate a factor 16. So you can also say, if you always put more stuff into it, then you can do things more easily. You will not invest so much brain in detail, but it means that your progress will not be in 60. The essential thing is, what do you make use of with the capacity you have? And of course, we have witnessed something over the last 60 years. We have this Moore's law factor 1000 in improvement in input-output efficiency for elementary operations, for bit operations. We have this factor 1000 every 20 years. And of course, the factor 1000 makes a big difference. You just have more, let's say, power. And 1000 times 1000 times thousands, it's a billion. Yeah. So it's eine Milliarde. Yeah? So that is already something. So you could say, okay, we will do it with sheer power. But, now comes the essential but, if you would always double our performance, if more laws would go on, it would still not help, because many problems have an exponential complexity, and 2 to the power 300 is already a number greater than all atoms in the universe. So, for a mathematician, 2 to the power 300 is a very small number. But it's more than all atoms in the universe. So even if we had a computer that could address every atom in the universe as a storage place, we could not store more than 2 to the power 300. So whatever we can do in technology, for real huge numbers, it doesn't help. And of course, Moore's law will not go on. We now see the limit of that. Maybe another factor 1000, and then it's done. So in a sense, we can say the main driver in the IT field is up to now the Moore's law, and we have more power. On the other hand, we know already for principal reasons that putting always more power into things will not solve the problems we have. There is problems we cannot solve with just more power. Now take two examples which we had in the media in recent times. One thing is that IBM did beat the chess world champion. It's now already 10, 15 years ago. And that quite recently, we saw that the Go champion was beaten by a machine. And of course, people say, you see, these machines become always more intelligent. They are better than humans. IBM also created Watson, and they did win in a kind of a Jeopardy contest, which is answering questions. And the interesting thing about Watson is that you do not ask, like you put a question and want the answer, you give the answer and want the question. It's a little more complicated. Yeah, it's a reverse engineering thing. You have the result, you want the starting point. Watson did the starting point. Okay, then we can say this machine is getting creativity. It is able to guess what the question was, seeing what is coming out. But if you deeper look into these issues, they very often of the type that we are in a space of unbelievable size, where neither the human nor the machine can fully control this space. We know in chess the number of possible constellation is 2^300. That is all atoms in the universe. No human, no machine can ever go through all options. In Go, it's much tougher. It's 2^300 times 2^300. It means for every atom in the universe, all atoms in the universe. This is the number of possible constellations. It can never be done in brute force by machines. Of course, it cannot be done by the brain. The brain does it this way, the machine does it that way. The machine is better than in the end than we, okay? But it doesn't say something principal about intelligence. It says something about this particular job. Now, before I come to the car, in the more recent time, we have now a big hype concerning AI. We have particularly also a big hype about the issue of big data. Big data and AI, in a sense, they seem to go together. Now, what really happens is we have, in many places, unbelievable amounts of data, and we now have, from the field of neural networks, algorithms that are able, in some cases, to draw some conclusions out of that data. So let's say you have a lot of medical data and certain people have a certain illness. And of course it would help if somebody has this strange idea that this illness is connected with people that are male and older than 53 years and have blue eyes. And if for whatever crazy reason, older than 53 years and male and blue eyes is somehow correlated with this illness, then of course it's nice to know. And now machines can try to find out whether there is any of these constellations. Now of course we could do this before, a human brain can do the same. And human brains did the same. And what you see is correlation. And correlation can make sense or not. Something else is causation. In causation, you understand what is the reason why a person being male, older than 53, with blue eyes, has a particular illness. In correlation, you only see that in your data, obviously, it is this kinds of people who have that illness. Maybe there is no connection whatsoever, it's only that in the data, there seems to be a connection. What we really need is a causation. What we can have is a correlation. And of course, machines can help us in doing correlation. Now, I spend the time to find a nice application for all this power of artificial intelligence to see correlations. And I tell you what was the best, what I found. Yeah, but of course, this is my personal taste. So this is a company that sells something like t-shirts and shirts and all kinds of stuff. Yeah, they sell such a stuff and they send the information to people and then these people order something. And now there is a marketing problem. If people order, there is a danger that 2 days later they will not want anymore what they wanted 2 days before. In marketing research, this is called cognitive dissonance after purchase. It's after purchase cognitive dissonance. So it's a very difficult issue. There are people who buy something and are frustrated 5 minutes later. Yeah? So if you give them 2 days, it's a disaster. Yeah? If you wait a week, they will send it back anyhow. Yeah? So this company has a problem to send the stuff out soon. But part of the stuff they order with somebody else. And now the problem is, of course, do they send, let's say, a partial material stuff with the things they have and the rest 3 days later? Or do they wait the 3 days to send everything in one package? Everything in one package needs longer. We could send half of it before. The problem is then if the second half comes, we send it then, we will probably send it back, but the second half is something we ordered from somebody else, so we would have maybe to give it back to him. It's so complicated. So what to do? Yeah? And of course, in the end, the thing is that you find out that people who order something in the past will probably order something in the future, and so you can prepare yourself for what probably will be ordered in the future. And then you can already order stuff from other people in advance and keep it in storage. And if you do it intelligently, then usually if somebody orders something, you will have everything available that he orders, so you can send it directly to him. Of course, you can interpret now as an artificial intelligence by which a machine does know already now what a person will order in a few days. It's always a very intelligent machine. But we did, of course, know the same thing before we had the machines. Because good people in marketing always did know what will be ordered more or less. Because the point is not that we can say a particular person will order particular that. We can say with 1 million customers, on average, we will have this kind of orders. We did this before and we do it now. Now it does, an algorithm does it. And the only difference is that we now can apply that algorithm every time to every data constellation, and we get this result. We don't need an engineer to do it. We don't need a statistician. The machine does it. It does it quite reasonably. But if you go deeper into it, it is not really something that is artificial intelligence. It is clever algorithms to make use of. Now let's come into the automotive sector and also ask what is the difference in the automotive sector to this more general situation of somebody purchasing t-shirts. Of course, the biggest difference is this is a machine, very powerful, very important machine that is able to generate a very high end. So you cannot have a rich society without cars. I did a computation once that even if you could have 50 slaves, you rather take one car. And the one car will improve your life more than 50 slaves. And by the way, it's a hard job to care for 50 slaves. Be happy you have no slaves. Be happy you have a car. You know? So this car is a wonderful, powerful machine. But of course, it operates in situations where one mistake, taking 1 second, can mean life or death. So it is an extremely dangerous environment. I think the most dangerous situation is, on general roads, that two people are willing to pass each other with speed 100. Because it's so dangerous if you're so close together and both have speed 100 and just one guy does something and that's the end. Yeah? And we do this all the time. We are extremely trustful in the stability of this situation and we are able to manage with our car because the car usually does what we want it to do. So if we do this, then it goes right, and if we do that, it goes left, and if we go on the brake, it brakes. Yeah? And the people creating the car, they have to put all kind of efforts in this kind of stability and reliability. It's very important. And of course now, to the degree we want to put more sensor information into the system, and to the degree that we want the system to do something on its own, the more we want that, the more dangers of a new type come into the play. And in particular if there is an option of interference from outside, then of course there is all kinds of risk of a kind of interference we don't want. Particularly if you see the terror issue and what you can do with trucks and cars, then the absolute horror would be somebody that is able from the outside to bring thousands of cars under his or her control and uses thousands of cars as devices to kill people. So in this area we have to be particular sensitive about security issues. And we have this problem of real-time requirements, because 1 second can make the difference. So we have to do it in real time. And of course, then there is all these insecurities about software. And I understood that in the past, in the cars, you had your own devices and let's say that were specially prepared, expensive, slow, but reliable. A little bit the same situation in the military. They had all their own components, and they were 3 times as reliable, and they were 3 times as heavy, and so on and so on, because they had a special situation. Now, the more you want to get into this general information topic, the more you want information from outside, you want to share with others, and so on, of course, the more you have to open into the software world in general. You have to combine your system with already existing systems and with existing operating systems and so on and so on. And now we have 2 problems. The 1 problem is, for sheer mathematical reasons, it is more or less impossible to prove that a certain software works correct. And you can have a very isolated part of software where you can have a mathematical proof under certain circumstances, but there is no general way to have a 100% guarantee about the software working correct. Particularly, it's even more difficult to have a guarantee that it does something in a certain time. So usually you always build a system in the way that you give the system time to compute something, but if until that and that moment there is nothing computed, then you have a fallback position, and that is what you do. And the fallback position very often is the essential thing, because the computation will not end. This is a general problem in software. It is called the stop problem. Mathematically, this problem is equivalent to the Gödel theorem on the incompleteness of arithmetic. That means, you can put it this way, we cannot build a universal Turing machine which for every Turing machine can tell you in advance whether this machine for every input will stop. I'm not talking about a time guarantee, I only talk about stopping. We cannot even guarantee that it will stop. It is not possible to do that in general. So whatever we do in this critical situation has also to deal with the possibility of the non-reliability of the software we have. And in some way, we have to integrate all this into a running system with which we in the market and as a people can live, even that there will be failures. Now, what I just said is somehow, well, it is like everyday bread. Yeah? It has nothing to do with AI hype. But what we see is a hype. We see a hype. We see people believing that in 10 years the cars will drive on its own, and they will drive in the cities. And we sit there, and I already was on conferences where the topic was, how do we entertain the human now sitting in the car and the car is driving? And I thought, am I here in a kind of hospital station? Yeah? So as if our own problem would be if I ask myself, did they never drive taxi? Yeah? Because I mean, the best you can have in an autonomous car is something like a taxi. I mean, you sit in your taxi and the taxi drives you. Yeah, so what? Yeah, I never asked for entertainment in a taxi. Yeah, the idea was, yeah, if we drive through a countryside, then we get films of the towns we pass by. Yeah, imagine you pass Munich. Yeah? You see always a Munich film. Yeah? So you understand this is a crazy hype situation. I think even in 30 years, you will have no car going into crowded inner parts of cities and driving on their own. I'm a member of the German Advisory Council for our traffic ministry. And we just did a report on autonomous driving and what is coming. There is, let's say, 5 levels of autonomy. And the best we will see in, let's say, the next decade is that on certain regulated lanes of streets or highways, the cars are allowed to do something. Or that in the city, near to a parking place, you can keep your car, and then it goes by its own into the parking place, and there is a control device of somebody who will control this remotely, that this car goes into the parking place. One of the most challenging issues we will see is what to do with people on bikes. I mean, we have a kind of development for electro-velos, big thing, but we have also these guys on most powerful machines. Yeah? And there is a big difference between a car and a big motorbike, because the driver on the motorbike, he has to keep the balance of this system in most critical situations. And there is a kind of young man who really tries to die. Yeah? So it doesn't matter what the situation is, they want to go around. Yeah? Now imagine you have autonomous cars. This is bonanza for young men. Because, you know, this car will always behave reasonably. You have only reasonably behaving actors, and then you come with your thing. Yeah? I'm certain they will all buy bikes, and they will have bonanza. This will be the most sexy thing, to go with this bike through all these autonomously driving cars that always stop. Yeah? I think also that young boys will have a big fun in pretending to run over the street, and then all these cars will stop and nothing can happen. Can you imagine what that will be? A wonderful party. So go away from all these ideas what will happen so fastly, and by the way, also go away from the idea that soon we will only have electric cars. This is all nonsense. There is no way to produce the electricity. Particularly, there is no way to produce this electricity CO2 neutral. There's absolutely no option to have all this energy somewhere stored. It will all not work the way people tell us. And of course, there is a reason for that. What people understood in the last decades is how you really make money. And to really make money, there's 2 things you can do. One thing is change your topic, go into the financial field. Yeah? If you once in your life succeed in a huge number in a database to add 1 0, you only need 1 0 once in a lifetime. But it must be a 0 at the end of a very big number. And if you then manage to have the difference between the number with the 0 and without the 0 somehow going to a secret account of yours, then you did it forever. 1 0. If you not work on 1 0, you have to create a hype. Hypes are a wonderful tool to make money. And you can be certain that a lot of the ideas for startups we have, of course, they all dream of the exit. But they want to have this new company and somebody has to buy it. Yeah? It's the exit. But for many people, the innovation they are up to is not the company purpose. The only company purpose is the exit. So, with other words, you need not to have a tool that works. You need people that believe that what you are doing is very dangerous and very attractive, and they want to buy it before somebody else buys it. And the only thing you work is that this thing is sexy, and then you want to have the exit, and that's it. And let's say at least 80% of all startups is nothing else but a device to have an exit, paid by an idiot. Huh? Okay, you can say however somebody buy this, but the problem is in many companies we have people that understand nothing, but they have money without end. So why not invest in a lot of startups? Maybe one works. So you have to see that you're part of that. And of course, there are examples like Google or Amazon, Facebook. And then everybody thinks, okay, I have to do it like Facebook. Facebook is a big thing, yeah? Now we call what is happening there at the moment, we call it platform capitalism. Platform capitalism. And platform capitalism is a very successful business. But essentially, it is a consequence of a technology that allows a new way to combine customers with somebody who has something to offer. Like people have to offer rooms, people need rooms, and now you have a platform that somehow does the connection, and this platform now organizes the most overnight stays at all in the whole world without owning a single room. Or with Uber, somebody does most of the taxi tours in the world, but he has no taxi. It's a very wonderful business, yeah, if you think about it, it's wonderful. All the other people work and you cash in, yeah? And you need essentially no people for that. And if you make it reasonable, you don't pay tax. So it's a very good thing, yeah? And in this environment, they are building fortunes. Billions. And of course, they think from morning to night, which next business to capture. And they have these billions to do that. And it should be clear to everybody that the automotive sector is a very attractive field of business to capture. Now, think about it like a chess party. Yeah? You have these Google guys that want to capture the automotive sector. Then you have these incumbent companies like BMW here. And they're really good, world prestige. They have the prime brands. You sit here with your prime brand, and there is this guys. They did it already two times. They have this billions of cash, and they want your business. And of course, it's clear you can only make it if you change the car. Because in the car as it exists, it's almost impossible to attack the incumbent who is the knowledge owner, who is the device owner, who is the actor owner. You cannot easily attack him. He is just so brilliant. So you must force him into a different car. But how should you force him into a different car? Now, you must tell him the car of the future will be autonomous and go on its own, and the main problem is to have a film. And then you must tell them, we will only have electricity and nothing else, and you can forget all your motors and all you have, forget it, doesn't matter. There will come this electricity, this is a new thing, everybody can do it, we will join the best forces, be aware of what we will do with electricity and internet. And in this hype, of course, the environmental argument is very strong to say, yeah, we have this global CO2 problem, so we cannot allow the cars to go with gasoline, and we must stop the gasoline, and we have to take electricity. Now, we did a computation in this advisory board for the German traffic ministry to get an idea what it would cost to compensate the CO2 emissions of cars. Because you can compensate CO2, for instance, by building trees or by generating humus in soil. And there is an estimate the world needs 1 billion hectares of degraded soils in the tropics to be reforested. It is formerly rainforest. The soil is now more or less not useful anymore for agriculture. We urgently have to reforest that. That would take billions of tons of CO2 out of the atmosphere. If you go for this kind of compensation schemes, you would have to make gasoline 3 cents more expensive, and then you could compensate all CO2 effects of gasoline. 3 cents a liter. We have 65-cent taxes on that. 3 cents more you wouldn't even notice. This is, by the way, the reason that the Greens do not want the automotive cars to be in the European certificate climate system. We could easily do the automotive sector into that climate system. But of course, everybody knows then there is no chance to make any more pressure on the automotive sector because they compensate what they do. And then a whole story of political activities will be gone. Let's say our argument is we will need a synthetic diesel and a synthetic gasoline, which in a sense is sun to liquid. We can take the sun of the African Sahara and create a gasoline and a diesel that is climate neutral, and then there is no climate problem anymore associated with having cars. There's a company here close by in Munich, name is Avia, and Avia does the diesel for heating in houses. And a few months ago, Avia announced climate-neutral petrol for houses, compensated CO2 in Africa. So if you now take this petrol, it doesn't cost any cent more. Avia solves the neutralization. If you take this Avia diesel for your house, then your heating is climate-neutral without doing any sanitation of your house. There is nothing more economically ridiculous than doing a complete energetic sanitation of a house for the purpose of helping the climate. Very often in the end you pay more money for the energy and you pay 100 times as much for 1 ton of CO2 not delivered into the air as if you would compensate enough. So let me come to a close. This is interesting times, and it's interesting technologies. And of course, what we can do with computers is always more impressive. But many problems in the world will not change by having intelligent technology. And there is one thing that will certainly not change. There is a principal difference between human and machine. The principal difference is not intelligence. The principal difference is not consciousness in the sense of having an idea who you are and what you are doing and what others are doing. So a car can easily have an idea that it is a car and what it means to be a car and that there is other cars and humans, and the car may even know that there are wild boars and that they may have 200 kilos and it's a certain problem if they run over the road if you're just driving. Yeah? But maybe the car will also know that soon this boar will be in the internet of everything, and then the wild boar will tell us that it comes, so the car has no problem to deal with a wild boar. There's one thing a car will never do. Feeling anything. So the main difference between humans, but also high mammals, let's say like an elephant or a cat An elephant and we feel something. A machine feels nothing. Of course, we can build a machine that pretends to feel something. We can say, machine, you know, in the state happiness. Then the machine says, if you ask in what state you are, say, I'm happy. And then the machine smiles, yeah? And it says, be happy with me. Yeah, okay, but is the machine happy? Of course not, the machine is a machine. And maybe you build a machine that if you kick her somewhere in the back, it says, aua, yeah? Oh, hurts. But of course you all know it hurts not, yeah? There's nothing what in a machine can hurt. Only humans and animals have something that can hurt. So the final issue will be about the division of power between machines that feel nothing and humans that feel a lot. I will even go a step further, that we feel something is the only reason that life makes sense. Imagine for 1 second you wouldn't feel anything. Why would you want to live if you feel nothing? Now imagine a machine, it feels nothing. Of course we can build a machine that has an algorithm that wants to optimize the control of the machine of the world and the control of the machine over humans. But why should we be so crazy to ever allow machines that feel nothing to control us, that we feel something? Of course we have people that say that it's so dangerous with humans feeling something, I need a computer to protect me against the feelings of other people. For instance, if you are stalked and you have a guy following you because he's crazy for you, and say, okay, you need a machine that helps me with these crazy guys. However, if in the end the machine has the control, then it doesn't matter anymore that you feel something because the world is controlled by a device feeling nothing. And that cannot be the future. And I hope we find a way between these two aspects of machines becoming more intelligent and helping us in a reasonable way, and us who feel something to stay in control. Thank you.